My name is Pedro. I'm iOS developer at SoundCloud. That's my username. You can find me on Twitter, GitHub. Please don't try to find me on YouTube if you want to get any surprise. Plus, that's my website. I usually write about iOS development, Swift, Objective-C. Today, I'm going to talk to you about how to modularize your apps in frameworks. And in order to do that, I will go through these points. First, I want to give you some context about what's the state of the iOS and Apple ecosystem platform development. I want to give you some motivation why it makes sense to modularize your app and how to do it. Plus, when I talk about this topic, many people come to me and ask me some questions. I would like to tell you about them and also give you responses and suggestions. Plus, I would like to give you some downsides if you decide to go with something like this. How many of you know what that thing in the screen is? Could you raise your hands? It's a box. As simple as that. So we use boxes to save things that have something in common. For example, we use them for love letters, for photos, for notes. But we are developers, and we don't work with these kind of things in a daily basis. Instead, we have something that we work with the headers, with the body files. If you are doing Swift, with Swift files. And you may be wondering if we have something similar to boxes in our ecosystem that we can use to put things together. Yes, we have it. It's something that it's called framework. And according to Wikipedia, this is what a framework is. I'm going to read it. A framework is a collection of implementations of behavior written in terms of a language that has a well-defined interface by which behavior is invoked. It's a collection. It means we put a bunch of things together. Plus, it has a behavior, what we usually know as a responsibility. Plus, it has to be written in a language, Swift, Objective-C, Java. Plus, it has an interface. It's a way to access whatever is inside that framework. Most of you are, I'm sure you are familiar with the frameworks because you use them with the external dependencies. Typically, you have something like this where you have your iOS app plus external dependencies, AF networking, MyGuard record, pure layout. This is an example of a pod file where you can define all the dependencies. You do pod install, and in a few minutes, you have everything integrated into your project. Typically, this is the setup, as I mentioned. So you have the app plus all these external dependencies. Thanks to tools like CocoaPods and Cartridge, the integration and dependency resolution is easy nowadays. When you start a project, usually it's a very simple app. Maybe it's an app with your colleagues. Maybe it's a side project. It starts as a few source files, maybe some storyboards, some data models. And usually when very small teams are not distributed, maybe you and two colleagues, or maybe five people working in the same place, which is good. It works. Typically for one or two platforms, 4 years ago, it was as Apple developers, we could only develop for these two platforms. But the market is changing constantly, and we don't know what's coming. And that's what happened in the Apple ecosystem when Apple decided to change it. And they said, now, you as a developer are going to be able to develop for these two extra platforms, for Watch and for TV. So you have something like this, the project with the iOS app, and then the product manager comes to you and say, hey, I have an idea. I'm going to work on I have an idea of a watchOS app. You think, oh, that's cool. Let's do it. So Apple tells you, oh, it's very easy. You have to actually create a framework. And then you pull everything that you want to reuse in that framework. OK, so I take the Swift files, Objective-C, put them in the framework, and it works. But it is not as easy as it sounds from Apple. Let's say this is our project with all the Swift files. We extract the first one, and OK, it works, no? But this one has a dependency with a different file inside the same project. So let's take that one out as well. We do the same, but that one as well has another dependency with that one. And that one has plus X external dependencies. So it's not as easy as it was at the beginning. So it's something like a nightmare. Apple says you can reuse code easily, but according to your architecture, it's taking you a lot of time. So what at the beginning was a very simple project, as you add more files and the team grows, everything turns to be more complicated. Plus, you figure out that you cannot reuse the code easily, and your code architecture doesn't scale as easy as you thought it would. With bigger projects also come big teams. For example, SoundCloud, 1 year ago, it was only 5 developers. Now we are 15. But also, we are distributed. We have people in New York. We have people in San Francisco. And working in a project like this, and monolithic project, it's super complicated because you have conflicts all the time. Teams are interdependencies, and I'm going to give you an example of what interdependency is and what that means in terms of conflicts. You have team A and you have team B. Team A changes that file, which is something normal. But then team B does the same. You think, oh, that's easy. You go to Git, resolve the conflicts, and that works. But let's say team B modifies that file. That file is a dependency of this other file. Since there is no integration test, suddenly you get a bug in the app, and you detect it maybe in production, maybe when the app is being used by users. That's a big problem. Plus, let's say you use one of these awesome files from Apple, storyboards and XT data models that were designed to be used in big teams. Just kidding. But when you have a conflict in these files, it's very hard to resolve the conflicts. If two teams modify the same file, the problem is even worse, because then you have to sit with the other team to see what they change in order to solve the conflicts. So not easy, right? That happened to us at SoundCloud, and we thought, hey, we have to solve this. We cannot be working every day, spending a lot of time solving conflicts. How can we solve this? The approach that we decided to take was modularizing the app. And this is something we called framework-oriented programming. And this is something I want to tell you about today. What I define as a framework-oriented programming consists in modularizing your apps in local and multi-platform frameworks that expose a hookable interface. I say local because the frameworks are also part of your repository where the application is. It's multi-platform because you can compile the same framework for different platforms, either tvOS, iOS, macOS. And finally, it's hookable, which means you can easily, from a different framework, you can access, it's a dependency, and you can access whatever you need from any of your framework dependencies. Building an app with this setup is something like gluing everything together. Think about different modules with different features. You put them together, you define your dependencies, and then you have an iOS app. You can have the same for the watch. You just take only the frameworks that you need. Let's say for SoundCloud, you only need the player. You take the player framework, and that's it. You build the app very easily. The only thing that the application does is connecting these dependencies and defining the navigation. That allows the teams to be atomic very easily. Then each team owns its own framework. So team A, instead of accessing the single project, team A has its own project, its own data model, and its own framework. And the same with team B. That means they can decide about a lot of things. They can decide about their persistence model. If they want to use Core Data, they can use Core Data. Ream, they can do the same. Plus, they can define about patterns. No, I want to use Model View Model. OK, do it. No, I want to use Model View Presenter. Why not? Third, the architecture. And finally, the language. What if any of your teams prefer to write the framework in C++? Or what if they want to do it in Swift? Why not? So at the end, they have their own framework. They can decide whatever they want. It's up to them. The frameworks have to expose an API because there are interactions between them. So they have to expose an API. For example, at SoundCloud, we are still using Objective-C, and there are people that want to do Swift. We are taking this as an advantage to say, hey, do Swift in your framework. The only thing that I need from you is that your interface is Objective-C compatible. So if you make sure that there is a contract between all the APIs, they can do whatever they want in private. Just give me the API. It's like if you think about web services, it's like accessing data, but instead of using the HTTP protocol, you just access the framework API. That means if we have the API, there's only one communication point. There's no imperatively you call everything that you need. There's only one way to access the framework. Then dependencies are decreased, so because there's only one way to communicate, Plus, as a result, the number of conflicts is also decreased, and you have fewer bugs in the app. But even though you have teams atomic, as I said, there are still some resources that are shared across all the teams. These resources are something like the kitchen, the disk, or user defaults. Let's say you have two teams trying to access disk. The first one creates a file, a folder. The other one removes the folder because the second one doesn't know anything about what the first team is doing. That's a big problem. How can we solve this? Well, what if we serialize the access to these resources? What if we have a framework that gives separates the disk in different folders and say, hey, team A, this is your A folder, team B, this is your folder. Whatever you want to do, it's going to be always in that folder. We can do the same with kitchen. If I assign you a namespace inside the kitchen, you make sure that two teams are not accessing the same elements in the shared resource. How can we do that? This is a question that I get very often because especially setups are very different. There are teams using Gitsu molds, there are people using CocoaPods, there are people that prefer to do everything manually. I'm going to give you a few ways to do it. Then I will give you some tips about which one is best for you. First one is using CocoaPods. If you are using CocoaPods already for external dependencies, this is the best setup for you, I will say. And it's very simple. You just go to create one frameworks folder, then you add, using the CocoaPods leaf create command, you can create as many pods as you want. Then you can also specify dependencies between different pods. For example, in this one, we have the player that has a dependency with core and with UI. And finally, in your pod file, you say, these are my dependencies, which are local. Plus, you say, all these targets, my iOS app, my TV app, and my WhatsApp, are going to be using this framework setup. It's very, very easy. You can also do things manually. It's not very complex. At the end, what you do is creating a workspace. If you are using CocoaPods, you can use the same workspace that CocoaPods creates for you. And then you link the dependencies and embed them into the project. If you look at that, we have different frameworks, which are different projects. Each project has the framework target plus the testing target. This playback framework has a dependency with the core framework, as you can see there. And core is another project inside the workspace. Something very important, this is kind of confusing. When you link the dependencies, it doesn't mean that the dependencies are going to be copied to the app. In order to do that, you have to specify to Xcode. If you go to build faces, there is a way to do it. You create a new copy build face, and you say, I want to copy all these frameworks to the frameworks folder. If you don't do that, the app will compile. When you try to open it, the application will crash. I mentioned at the beginning that something very interesting is making these frameworks multi-platform, because we want to, I don't know, the search framework have it available for watchOS. This is a trick that one of my colleagues told me, and I think it's very useful. It's not documented. But at the end, since you have xt-config files, you can specify the config as you want. You can say something like supported platforms, support all these platforms. So suddenly you have the framework working for all these platforms. And you can also use regular expressions like here, where you say, depending on the SDK, the architecture that you usually use is different. For macOS, I want to use this one. For iPhone, I want to use this one. And you can also change the framework search path. If you notice here, macOS has an extra search path compared to the other platforms. If you do that, then you get something like this. Your framework core, you can compile it for all the existing devices. While I was doing this at SoundCloud, I was like repeating the same steps all the time. Creating the project, creating the target, adding the playgrounds, adding the examples project, connecting dependencies, and I thought, oh, this is taking me a lot of time. I have to write something to make this more automated. So I came up with this tool. It's a command line tool written in Ruby. Basically, you say Pandora create the name of the framework and the organization, and you get something like this. It's a project with the framework, has the the framework target, the testing target, one example app, so you can test the framework in that examples app, and also include some playgrounds so you can import your framework and play with it. You can install it with Gem, and then you can create frameworks easily. As I mentioned at the beginning, I would like to give you some questions that people ask me and some answers, because this is kind of confusing sometimes. The first question that I get is, what about external dependencies? Because I have this app with tons of pods, how can this setup work with these external dependencies? Well, first recommendation is that try to minimize them. We don't want to be JavaScript developers. I know CocoaPods makes things very easy, but please, when you think about using external dependency, think if you really need it. If you don't need it, don't spend time specifying the dependency, because when you depend on that dependency, you have to maintain it. And second, if thinking about frameworks, if the framework has a lot of dependencies, try to not have any external there. Because if you have it, it means it's not only dependency of you, but dependency of all the frameworks on top of you. So the closer the framework is to the app, the more frameworks, external frameworks, you can have. CocoaPods or cartridge? Well, this is up to you. This doesn't have to do anything with this framework-oriented programming. At the end, these are tools that allow you to bring these external dependencies. Both support local and external dependencies. So as I mentioned before, you can define your pods locally, and your local pods can also have external dependencies, so you can easily use any of these tools. And of course, it depends on your setup. If you are using CocoaPods, my recommendation is that you continue using CocoaPods. If you use cartridge, do the same. How many of you know the difference between dynamic and static? Okay. So the difference is very simple. When you link something statically, it means you link everything when you compile the app. So you compile everything, everything is linked, and then you launch the app. But when you do it dynamically, what it does is it compiles everything. When you open the app, then it links everything. That's why, I don't know if you noticed, when you migrate CocoaPods to use frameworks, suddenly your 30 external dependencies became framework, and you were complaining about CocoaPods because your app was taking a lot of time to open. That was because of that, because the more dynamic linking that you have in the startup time, the more the app takes to open. But Swift only supports dynamic linking, so if you plan to do Swift in frameworks, you are forced to do it dynamically. Moreover, Apple recommends to have no more than 6 frameworks. This is getting better. In iOS 8, it took a lot of time to open the app, but in iOS 10, I think it improved a lot. So hopefully it will get better from Apple. As I said as well, difference between linking and embedding. Linking is connecting these dependencies. This player has a dependency with core. But if you don't copy them, it's not, the app doesn't work. You have to copy them. You have to embed them. And you have to embed them only if it's an app. You cannot embed, you shouldn't embed a framework into a framework. You can do it, but when you try to push the app to the store, it will say, hey, this framework has another framework copied inside. Another tip that I would like to give to you is do some kind of reverse engineering, because the documentation is very bad. What I was doing was basically trying to understand how CocoaPods work. And it's not that hard. If you do pod install, you go to build phases, you notice this, it says, well, we are embedding the pods frameworks. They are embedding the pods frameworks. So they use a bash script because they cannot modify the build phases. So everything that I mentioned before, they can do it with a script. Now they change your configuration file of your project. These are all the SoundCloud dependencies. We have a lot. But look at this here, sorry. So you say this app is linked against this framework. It's called Fabric. Plus, you have to find this framework in this folder, pods root / fabric / iOS. And if you need headers, you can find the headers here. That's it. Instead of going to build settings and changing things, they just change the configuration file of your project. And I think that's awesome. Some people complain about, hey, CocoaPods is modifying my build settings. OK, they are changing the configuration file, but it doesn't really touch your build settings. They just change the configuration file. What if I have a big monolithic project and I want to transition into this modularized app? How can I do it? Well, First thing is you should think about extracting the tooling. You have to extract the API layer if you use Core Data or any other persistent solution. If you have a wrapper, extract it. The same with analytics and logging. And then once you have these tools extracted, you can start pulling features like now I extract search, now I extract the player. You put them in a framework, you use the tooling that any other framework provides you with, and then you link your app against this new feature framework. How many frameworks? Someone asked me that question. Well, it depends on your setup. As I said before, if you do dynamic linking, Apple tells you no more than 6. So sometimes when you have to design the frameworks, you have to be a little bit like thinking it's going to be restrictive. So we are at SoundCloud, we are starting with frameworks, so only a few of them. And as Apple gets better at this, we will probably split them in more thinner and smaller frameworks. And also, this depends a lot on your kind of setup that you have in your project. For example, if you're a freelance, freelance want to reuse as much code as possible between different apps. So if every time I write an app, I have to write the API client or the Core Data access layer, why don't you extract it into a framework? It can be three of them, or it can be just my freelance kit, whatever. And then whenever you start a new project, you link the project against your tooling kit, and that's it. You save a lot of time. But what if the team is very big, it's distributed, and then you want to have different teams working in different frameworks? So you can have something like this. This is the approach that we have at SoundCloud. We have a core team. This is the team that provides with the tools for API, for Core Data. Then we have different feature teams. They have their own framework, they have their own example app, and whenever they have the features ready, they just ping the application and say, hey, now we want to integrate this feature into the app, and we just do it. It can also happen that you are not a big team, you are a small team, but you plan to support multiple platforms, as I introduced the talk. So in that case, you need your application kit that allows you to reuse the business logic across all the existing platforms. One or multiple repositories, because as you start adding projects, maybe it may be interesting for you to do some versioning. And people ask me, oh, do you go with one, with two, three? How do you do it? What I recommend you to do if you don't want to introduce overhead on this is go with one repository, so you have everything in the same place. Unless, for example, there is another team that needs any of your frameworks, let's say any. In SoundCloud, we have a creators team. Let's say they need the core framework. So we get this one, we extract this one into its own framework, we introduce versioning, and they can access the core framework from the repository. Or let's say you want to make the framework open source. So in this case, you have to extract it because you don't want to give everyone access to your code base. With versioning, if you have everything in the same place, as I said, you are going to be versioning everything at the same time. Unless you have the frameworks in different repositories, in that case, you have to version because otherwise you cannot track the changes and the new improvements that come with new versions. But something very useful if you keep everything in the same place is to use deprecation macros. Let's say you are a core team and then you change the API a little bit and you want to force everyone to use the new API. What you can do is to introduce a deprecation macro, so you tell everyone, hey, this method is going to be deprecated. Think about using the new one. So you force everyone to transition, and once the no one is using that method, you can remove it. Public, private, internal, there are more types now with Swift 3. What about the visibility whenever I define something in a framework? We are very used to do everything in the same place in the app, which means everything is internal by default. We don't care about the visibility. But when we extract things into a framework, it's something very important to have in mind. You should keep everything internal by default. If you define something as internal, it means no one from outside can access that element. But you should only expose the API. You should only allow developers to access what you consider they should access. You should define that API, and that API should be the public one. Be very restrictive in that sense. So don't allow developers to extend classes. Don't allow developers to modify whatever they need, because if you do it, you know we are developers. If we see something is not working for us, we work around the problem, and we ship it. So if you are very restrictive, whenever they need something, they will come to you and say, hey, I need this from Core. Could you help me to get this thing? And then you can sit with him or her and analyze how to bring that feature into the framework. That's very useful to enforce good practices, because since they only have that public API, that's the only thing that they can use. And you tell them how to access it. Even though it sounds very ideal and good, and I'm sure most of you would like to try it, there are some downsides. It's not as easy as it looks. First, the documentation from Apple is not very good. Well, they tell you about frameworks, they tell you about static linking, but they don't tell you about how to put everything together and combine them and come up with something like this. APIs don't have homogeneity. If you compare, for example, Core Data API in iOS, Watch, TV, macOS, the API is different. For example, they don't have a macOS NSFetch result controller, which means if you are using that in a framework, then your framework, which is compatible for macOS, doesn't have that feature. So how can you work around this problem? Hopefully, Swift has something like this, where you can change or define the logic depending on the platform. So you can say, if my platform is not macOS, this is wrong, actually. If the platform is macOS, then it should use the type alias image, which uses NSImage. If it's other platform, it can use UIKit, where the type alias points to UIImage instead. Also, Xcode is very bad at this. Typical problems are suddenly one of your frameworks is not compiling because of an error, but you are trying to compile the app instead. Then the app doesn't compile, and then you get an error with no info, like, hey, it doesn't compile, and you are like, what's going on here? So you have to go down to the deepest framework, and start compiling from that, and go up in that hierarchy until you get to the app. And most of the times, it doesn't compile because there is a bug in any framework. So you have to go to that framework, make sure that one compiles, and then go back to the app and compile it again. That's it. Xcode sometimes is not very explicit with errors, and it takes sometimes a lot of time to figure out where the errors come from. And so conclusions of the presentation, I would like to tell you a few things. First one is try to go with this approach if right now you have a lot of conflicts in the team and you don't want to spend a lot of time solving these conflicts, give them their own framework and allow them to work in their own space. Also, I mentioned before that something kind of useful is that once you have the framework, you can have an example app. So you don't have to test your new features in the main app. You have to you have your own app, and you can test everything there. Once the feature is working, then you can get that feature and put it in the app. But you can test everything independently from the app. With that, it's very easy to build multi-platform apps. In my experience, using that setup, working on a macOS app or a watchOS app, it's all about defining the UI and defining navigation, because everything is already defined. You can also extract view models, and you can reuse view models between multiple platforms, because most of the times the views are similar. The only thing that changes is the UI. And also, it's very good for enforcing good practices. When you have everything together in the same framework, it's very easy to modify files, also extend things that you need. And you don't have a way to restrict it. You have to go to the pull request and say your friend, hey, you modify this, oh, you shouldn't do that. Whereas if you have your own framework with your own boundary, if someone tries to access that, you restrict it. And then if you want to do something else, then they have to come to you. So you enforce people communicate more between different teams. And finally, yeah, do it only if your project needs it. Because if it's a simple app, if you don't plan to support different platforms, you can start just with one target. And as the project evolves, you can think about adding more frameworks in the future. Few references. The first one is a website that I created in order to talk about the tools, some documentation that I see. Also give some tips about how to go with frameworks and how to apply the solid principles to this setup. There is an article about how to build modern frameworks. This one, very interesting. This one about how to create frameworks for iOS. The difference between framework and library, The difference is that the framework can include resources like storyboards, fonts, and images. Libraries can't. Static and dynamic. And this is very useful because it explains you things about xtconfig that Apple don't tell you about. And that's it. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. And if you have any question, please feel free to ask me.
I have two questions.
Yes.
One, I've heard about technique of merging frameworks just after building the application, so it should reduce compile time. And the question is, have you tried it? At SoundCloud?
To merge frameworks, you say?
Yes.
No, we haven't tried it. We know we'll have some issues with this. There are some tricks, people explaining you how to improve this linking time, but so far we didn't reach that point, so cannot.
Okay, and the second question is, how do you approach localization in such a modularized architecture?
Well, we haven't thought about that yet, but I guess we'll move. We have a UI framework or design framework. Maybe we have its own localization framework that everyone has access to. We move everything down to that framework. So if you need localization from search, you can get it from there. Have its own framework for that specific part, or maybe put it in core.
Okay. So maybe one more question. How long does it take you to move from monolithic architecture to modularized one?
A lot of time, especially if the project is very big. It's not easy because as you start extracting things, you notice how many dependencies these things have. So you start with something, no, this thing has another dependency, so you continue with the second one. So we think about right now what we are doing is we have the core framework. We are pulling the API tooling, the core data tooling, and then we are allowing the feature teams to access these new tools. So we work with them to see if the new APIs work for them, and from that point, continue like pulling stuff out. We'll say maybe 1 year, 2 years, I don't know, it takes time. And we are taking this as a big opportunity to do Swift, because if we try to add Swift in the same project, then you have to be from Objective-C accessing Swift, from Swift accessing Objective-C. Sometimes you have cross dependencies and tons of issues. So if we move everything into our framework, then you can do Swift there. As I said, you just make the API Objective-C compatible, and then we can hook that framework from the app because the app is Objective-C. And in private, you can use whatever you want from Swift generics and enums. Okay, thank you very much.